से ऊपर उन्होंने मार्क्स स्कोर किया है और लखनऊ यूनिवर्सिटी में भी मैक्सिमम मार्क्स 75 ही आए थे और उनके वाईडी पीजी कॉलेज लखीमपुर से वो स्टूडेंट था। तो वो इन डॉक्टर ईस्ट प्रभु की एनकरेजमेंट से, मेंटरिंग में, टीचिंग की वजह से ही वो इतने आगे तक आ सका। और उनका साधुवाद देते हैं और बहुत ही इम्पोर्टेंट टॉपिक लेकर के वो आए हैं जितना हमें पता चला है। लेट्स सी व्हाट इज गोइंग टू टेल अस एंड प्लीज पुट ऑन योर वीडियो डॉक्टर ईस्ट प्रभु।
Screen sharing is not permitted. Yes. Okay. I think my screen.
You are sharing. Yes, it is sharing. But yes, yes.
Yes, sir. It is visible to us.
Yes.
मेरा स्क्रीन आप सबको दिख रहा ना?
दिख रहा
है। Yes, sir.
इसको फुल स्क्रीन कर दीजिए स्लाइड।
Yes, कर रहा हूँ। कर चुका हूँ। धन्यवाद। मेरी आवाज अब तक आ रही होगी।
Yes, sir.
Thank you. All the respected faculty members, the audience, and dear students. मेरा नाम मिस्टर विभू है और पहला परिचय यही है कि मैं यहाँ का स्टूडेंट रहा हूँ और इस समय मैं वाईडी कॉलेज के स्टूडेंट्स को बीएससी की फिजिक्स पढ़ाता हूँ। आई एम थैंकफुल टू अंचल मैम फॉर गिविंग मी अ टेम्पोरल विंडो ऑफ 10 मिनट्स और सो so that I can share with you a glimpse of a very important topic of quantum optics, that is Hanbury-Brown and trace interferometry. Any student who has not been initiated in the field of quantum optics and quantum advanced quantum mechanics would ask why I have chosen this topic. The reason why I have chosen this topic lies in the fact that effect noticed by Hanbury Brown and Twist during a period from 1954 to 1956 challenged classical or quasi-classical models of light, and the words of A.M. Fox gave birth to quantum mechanics. So here lies the importance of the fact, this effect. In fact, Hanbury Brown and Twist were engaged in designing a stellar radio interferometer to measure the diameter of a distant radio star, and they made a kind of interferometer in 1954. This interferometer was a kind of improvement over the previous stellar interferometer made by Michelson, but it was different in that it was a kind of intensity interferometer, whereas the Michelson's interferometer was a phase interferometer. Few controversies arose, and just out of enthusiasm, Hanbury and Twist in 1956 conducted a laboratory test, a kind of tabletop experiment, to verify whether the same methodology they used for radio stars would work for visible stars or not. The results of this experiment were astonishing because they challenged the classical expectations. It was expected that there would be one photon, and they found that there are two photons arriving at the detector simultaneously. So in their own words, this was like they have put the cat among the pigeons, and जैसे कबूतरों के बाड़े में बिल्ली को छोड़ दिया गया हो। This started a kind of a storm in forging new lines of theoretical reasoning, experimental setups, which ultimately led to the evolution of modern branch of quantum optics has been. Before I move further, I want to put a kind of disclaimer. There are many subtleties of quantum physics involved in this experiment, but I would gloss over them so that it does not become boring for first timers and remains in the time limit. These are the prerequisites. I would just skip them. I hope that all the students of graduation and student who have studied physics in 12th would be having at least a vague idea of these things. The concept of photon is very enigmatic, and I would hide behind the words of Rob Glober, who was given Nobel in 2005. He said, a photon is what a photodetector detects. That means it is the light-matter interaction which would define the characteristics of the light. And the second question about the locality of the photon, that is where the photon is located, is again determined by the light matter interaction, that is by the interaction with the observer. This is the list of quantum mechanical properties of the photon. I would escape. Coherence is easy to understand in terms of classical electromagnetic theory, but it becomes tough in context of quantum mechanical description of light, because phase of photon is not well defined. Though we can define the phase of a coherent light field can be precisely known, the phase of the individual photons that create this field considered individually cannot define. But with coherence is related the visibility of fringes. If this is the sources are highly coherent, perfect visibility would be obtained, and if the coherence is very poor, the visibility would be poor. In order to measure this interrelationship between variables, a statistical property is defined. With first statistical property which I would use is first order correlation, that is the average value of the operator A in context of quantum mechanics. And in classical discrete system, this is defined in usual BSc textbook. If we want to consider the interrelationship between two variables, we define a kind of correlation function, which is defined here as g1 tau. And it has been established in that this g tau is same as the visibility of fringes. So coherence is measured in terms of correlation function, and visibility of fringes is also a measure of degree of coherence. So three things are correlated: coherence, correlation function, and visibility of fringes. Second order correlation is a kind of correlation between square terms. Field correlations in phase interferometers are first order correlations, whereas intensity correlations used in intensity interferometers are second order correlation. I would skip this slide, which deliberates how the Michelson's interferometer works. There are many subtle things involved. There was an issue with Michelson's stellar interferometer that if we increase the separation between outer mirrors, which is shown as D here, the mechanical stability of the mirror becomes difficult. And this disrupts the formation of sustainable interferometer fringes. And since this is based on observing the visibility of fringes, Michelson stellar interferometer does not remain as effective as it was. Radio astronomy was in its infancy in the period between 1920 to 1954, and an experimental device was needed to know whether certain prominent radio emitters were straw-like or extended source. And here came the master stroke of Hanbury-Brown and Twiss's stellar interferometer, which they devised in 1954. Instead of using two mirrors, they used two radio dish antenna, and the signals were received on these radio antenna, and they were focused directly onto separate photomultipliers by here shown as green cylinders. The signal from these two photomultipliers is fed to some kind of correlator, which results in the product of or average value of the product of current, photo current coming from these two photomultiplier tubes. So in effect, this result was measuring the second order correlation between the input signals. Again, this changed from field interferometry to intensity interferometry, and first order correlation instead of first order correlation, which were being measured in context of Michelson's interferometer, we started measuring second order correlation. This was a master stroke of Hanbury-Brown and Twiss's stellar interferometer. If the issue, there was a theoretical problem with this experiment. If each individual photo detection event is a statistical quantum process, how can separate events be correlated with each other? And but Hanbury, Brown and Twist found that the current flowing through these two photo detectors are highly correlated. So if I1 is high, I2 is high. This was unexpected from the classical statistical point of view. The second issue was that radio stars were found to be very large. A simple ordinary phase interferometer would have worked as well. So in words of Hanbury, he said that I was spending my 2 years on building a steamroller to crack a nut. Maine ek road roller banaya ek mungfali ko todne ke liye. That was the statement of Hanbury. But they were enthusiastic and they moved further and they thought we can use the same set for visible light or not, or for visible stars or not. So they started doing an experiment which is known as photon correlation experiment. Hanbury Brown Twist experiment on photon correlation. They did this experiment in 1956. They used a mercury lamp which emits a visible light in this wavelength range 435.8 nanometer. So instead of radio waves, we are using now visible light. This visible light is incident on a beam splitter, 50-50 beam splitter. The light coming from this 50-50 beam splitter, one is transmitted and one is reflected, is received by two photomultiplier tubes. The signal from these two photomultiplier tubes is fed to a correlator, which ultimately gives the average time average value of the product of the current. Again, second order correlation was measured in this apparatus. Since the mercury lamp was a very feeble source, the amplitude of the electromagnetic signals used was very small. This amplitude was very small, the number of photons inside the apparatus was very small, and it was calculated that almost one single photon is inside the apparatus. So if there is one inside the apparatus, how can there be two photons detected at two different photo detectors? But Hanbury, Brown and Twist claimed that two photons had been detected at the same time. They found that second order correlation function for thermal chaotic light is 2 for tau, which falls to 1 as the value of tau, that is the correlation time, which depends on the separation between this path length. And second order correlation function for coherent light is 1. For laser light, it is 1. For thermal chaotic light, it is 2, which falls to 1 gradually. So these, the first curve is the curve which is the curve shown in the upside of the figure. It was observed by Hanbury, Brown and Twist. And the straight line curve is the theoretical curve for laser light, which was later done. So, because of the same thing I have said, I quote from the same paper they have reported in 1956. This experiment shows beyond question that the photons in two coherent beams of light are correlated. That means one photon is striking at photomultiplier tube 1, the second photon is also striking at photomultiplier tube 2. And how can it be possible? So this experiment shows beyond question that the photons in two coherent beams of light are correlated and that this correlation is preserved in the process of photoelectric emission. This started a kind of a storm in physics world. And I would not go into the details of how theoretical models were developed to explain this, how experimentally other things were done. I would give one quote from a famous paper of Rao Glauber, which where in 1963 he said, I quote, "The present paper, which is the first of a series of fundamental problems of optics, is devoted largely to defining the concept of coherence." This was easy for us in classical optics. It was easy to draw a wavefront and see that these two points are spatially coherent. But in context of a quantum optics, it becomes extremely difficult. We do this by constructing a sequence of correlation functions for the field vectors and by discussing the consequences of certain assumptions about their problems. Glauber again writes, the definition of coherence which we reach differs from earlier ones in several significant ways. The coherent condition, the coherence conditions restrict randomness of the field rather than their bandwidth, which was the classical notion. This was the paper for which Glauber was awarded Nobel in 2005. So from here onward, a flurry of activities started in physics. Theoretical modeling was done. New experiments were done. These are four famous experiments which sometimes some of your teachers would tell. This is the Clausers experiment, in which they found anti-correlation between two photons in atomic cascades. And this is the Kimball's and Mendel's effect, as similar to this previous experiment in which anti-bunching was observed. This is the aspect, Alan Aspect's famous experiment in quantum mechanics, in which he established the Bell's inequality and challenged EPR paradox. And this is Hong Ho Mendel, in which they found that two photons were highly anti-correlated in certain conditions. So this Hanbury-Brown and twins experiment cancelled the idea that severely attenuated chaotic light can produce single photons. Initially, it was assumed if you reduce the intensity of the light, the number of photons emitted by it would be very low, and some condition can be reached and only a single photon is being emitted by the source. This was challenged by this experiment. So we started new ways for characterizing single photon sources. At the moment, HBT effect is being employed in every important branch of physics, whether it is high energy physics, it is nuclear physics, atomic physics, or condensed matter physics. It is something which I like to discuss with my students. There is an interesting proposition made by a philosopher of science, Peter Galison, that a trade between different subcultures of science, that is engineering, experimental physics, and theoretical physics, is possible and facilitates it the discovery. What is trading, Joe? One of the scientists is experimentalist and the second one is theorist. And this happened in the case of HBT effect. How? Hanbury Brown is a trained experimentalist. He was a British astronomer. He was having a degree in electrical engineering. And Richard Weiss was a mathematician, a theoretician. These two people came together and gave a beautiful experiment. The experiment was initially meant for radio astronomy, and gradually it gave results which had implication on the nature of quantum behavior of optics or photons. So this is beauty of this experiment. It was like throwing pebbles. These are the few words I think a student should think for a while. What are photons? What is bunching? What is anti-bunching? What are single photon sources? What is a spontaneous parametric down conversion? What is atomic cascades? What are squeeze light, qubit, intensity interferometer, radio astronomy, correlation, coherence theory? These are random words for a while. But gradually, if you ponder over, you would start finding a rhythm in between them. And with this, I say thank you to all. I wish you all a very bright celebration of International Day of Light. Thank you, ma'am. Thanks for giving me time.
That's thank all. You, Dr. Ishvibhu. Could you please put on your video camera so that everybody may see you also?
I was saving my bandwidth.
I know. Yeah. That's why I didn't interrupt in between. But now I would like to see you along with all the audience. Yes.
Oh. No. I'm not getting this.
Yes, you are seeing.
Yes, it is.
That was a wonderful lecture, and I want to convert it into a talk, but not here. at some time later, physically when you are here in the university, and you took quite a tough topic, but our students would have enjoyed it, and they have known that intensity interferometry has been widely used in radio astronomy, and what are correlation functions, first order, second order, and how the laser would do, talking about the thermal sources also, mercury sources also, and how the concept of coherence should be modified in their minds that they have to work out. And thank you very much for bringing a very apt, very new for the students, a topic of Henry Brown twist experiment, which is a new बच्चों के लिए, क्योंकि वो amplitude की बजाय intensity की बात अब आ जाती है, जो उनके लिए नया concept हो जाता है. Thank you very much.
Notion of phase is lost.
Yes, और आपको बहुत बधाई इसके लिए. And now over to Sonu for results.
मैम कोरोना के टाइम पे